For children. I write picture book scripts, the text for children. I'm not an artist. I don't do the illustrations. And I write poetry, novels, middle grade novels, and a novel in verse have also written.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much. And to your nice dog as well.
I have a dog named Winston. He got poems. And I would tell them to my mother and she would write them down. And that started when I lived in Mulberry Street, which is a perfect place for a children's book writer to grow up,
Mulberry Street
in Mount Carmel, in southern Illinois.
Oh, yeah.
I remember looking out the window. We had a sun porch on our house, and I looked out the window over at the Methodist Church across Mulberry Street, and there were pigeons, naturally, to church. They hung out there. And I was watching these pigeons. It was a beautiful black and white pigeon. Usually they're dull gray.
Right.
And I don't remember the poem, but I made up a few words. They rhymed. All my poems rhymed then.
Yeah, right.
And I made up a few lines of poetry about this pigeon. And I thought, wow, I can't catch that pigeon, but I can catch that pigeon.
Yeah.
And that was pretty exciting.
How neat.
And so I wrote poems. I made up poems. My first rejection was from Wee Wisdom. And, you know, the little children's magazine, I had submitted a poem to them, and it was rejected.
How old were you?
I probably was nine or ten.
Yet you weren't crushed.
Oh, no, I wasn't too crushed. Now, I handled that one pretty well, and I continued receiving, you know, I had the subscription. I didn't cancel my subscription because they wouldn't publish me. And then I wanted to write a novel. I must have been 13. We had a school that went first grade through eighth grade. So when I was in eighth grade, 13, I was working on a novel, and this girl was going to go to England because I always wanted to go to England. In fact, some of my earlier reading, we had a library back then. It was the Carnegie Library.
Uh-huh.
And you would go into the library, get your library card, okay, when I think you could have been six or seven, but you could only check out three books, and you couldn't go to the adult section until you were 13.
Oh.
And I remember I wanted to read thick books. And so instead of, she said, oh, why don't you read Nancy Drew? And I've been there, done that. So I found the biggest, thickest book I could find in the children's. And it was The History of the Kings of Scotland.
Oh,
do you know that book?
Yes.
It's wonderful. So I checked that out and I read that and I felt, you know, very mature.
Right.
When I was 13, I got to go back to the stacks, to the adult section.
Library.
But still, you could only check out three books. And so when we moved to Minnesota, and they have however many libraries they have, 99 libraries or more, one card will access all the counties around Minneapolis, St. Paul.
Oh.
You could take out as many books as you wanted. It was like heaven.
Yeah.
So I wanted to go to England, and it was my wish fulfillment novel. And I started this novel longhand and wrote, and finally the girl got to England. You know, I was almost through the novel. And I thought, well, I obviously am one of these people that writes too long of a first chapter that needs to be revised because the story doesn't start until later. And I don't think I ever finished that novel. But I went to high school, was on the newspaper.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote an occasion poem every 2 weeks for the newspaper. So I have a poem from Armistice Day and various poems that I would write for occasions. And by the time I was a senior, I was the editor of the newspaper. And I worked at the newspaper, the Daily Republican Register, it was called at that time, which had belonged to my great-grandfather. Frank Walden Havill had owned the newspaper at one time. Back in 1870s or 1880s, after he had been a captain in the Civil War, and then he got into the newspaper business, and so it was kind of interesting to be there doing the collecting the money from the paper boys on Saturday. That was my first job. You know, the paper boys came in and they would dump all their coins, and then you would collect the money, and then I used to proofread when they had the annual taxes. Did you ever proofread listings of taxes.
Oh, oh.
Oh my God.
And then I got to do the social columns. And they were, people would call in about a wedding in one of the nearby counties, and it'd be a country wedding, and they would call in, and I tell you, you had to get that right. If they had the right color, the linen, the lace, everything had to be described perfectly, and they are either scrawling this and sending it to you or doing it to you over the phone, you're telling you over the phone. So.
Not to mention spelling their names correctly.
Oh, spelling it. And you heard about it. You heard about it. When you got it wrong, you heard about it. So I learned a lot about professional journalism, and enough to know that deadlines make me anxious, very anxious. And then from there, I went to the University of Illinois and studied English, as a lot of writers do.
But not journalism.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Been there, done that.
Right.
No, I studied English literature, and I was also very keen on French, and I did a year abroad, my junior year. And so I went to France and studied in Rouen, which I think they had us go there so we could master the OO and the R sound. I was in Grenoble for a while and then Rouen, and then came back, did a master's in French, and then decided to go back and live in France. I think Nixon was president at the time.
Oh, my.
It was almost a political decision, and
left
Urbana with my suitcase and... you know, maybe three changes of clothes, and a friend I had in Paris who had been the house mother at the Maison Française, which is a French house where I worked as a resident. Went there to Paris and lived and wrote, didn't write a few essays, and did translation, worked for the OECD. And then my husband, whom I had actually met in Urbana, came to Paris and we got married. And it was not until my children were born back in the States, we came back to the States, and actually my daughter was born in France, in Neuilly, and we came back to the States when she was about 18 months old. Reading all those children's books, oh wow, I realized that's what I wanted to do.
All right.
I mean, they were wonderful. For some reason, I had kind of not, I don't know why, I had not read that many children's books. I kind of went from Hurlbut's Book of Bible Stories to Shakespeare. And, you know, the Shakespeare stories, those wonderful stories. And I just hadn't read a lot of picture books. And so reading them to my children who, you know, were just listening at that time. And I just thought, I really want to do this. And I began reading and reading and reading, because that's what you do.
Right.
If you want to be a writer, you read. And if you want to write children's books, you kind of have to know what that animal is. I just love them. When we moved to Minneapolis, I took a class in writing for children, continuing education, and I was staying at home, working at home, not making money writing then, and I studied with Emily Buchwald. I don't know if you know Emily. Mm-hmm. Emily was teaching, I believe that was the last class she taught through continuing education. She was at the University of Minnesota. Shakespeare was her thesis and her bag. She founded Milkweed Publications.
Oh, yes.
Heard of Milkweed.
Yeah.
And she was there for many years, retired, I don't have the dates right, but it's been maybe 6 years ago. And from there, she founded a press called the Griffin Press, for whom I just did a book in 2010.
Oh.
So we sort of came full circle, for her being my teacher to her being my publisher and editor.
Yeah.
So I had that class and met several women in Minneapolis, St. Paul area. And we formed a writer's critique group. I'm thinking that must have been 1982. And we were faithful and met twice a month, no matter what the weather was. And you know what that can be like.
Yeah.
Until I moved in 1991.
Hmm.
So
and moved here in 1991.
Moved to Cave Creek.
Cave Creek, Arizona.
Moved to Arizona in 1991.
Yeah,
my first book was actually a work for hire. You're familiar with work for hire, and you've all heard of Parker Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
A publisher and editor from Parker Brothers, or from Little Brown, had gone to work for Parker Brothers to do children's books that are associated with the mascots for football. You know, like the football teams had mascots. And they wanted to have these books done that you would choose one of the mascots or fit the mascots in somehow, like the Miami Dolphins and the... I don't do football, so I really didn't know too much about it, but I wrote children's books, and I had sent some samples, and that's how they decided to ask me, you know, based on the samples, to assign me a story. And they gave me one, and so I began to write about these mascots. They gave the characters and the more or less a plot line.
Formula and, fiction for children.
Yes, exactly. It was, and yeah. As a work for hire, you don't have total control over what, you know, is going to be printed in the end. So I used a pen name, Jennifer Havill, which is my name in Welsh and German. So that's what I used. And that book, the Wacky Rule Book, is, I think, still out there. It didn't get initially west of New Jersey. But
west of New Jersey.
I don't think so.
It took me a moment to do the geography.
That's where it started. So it didn't get far. But another publisher picked it up. And subsequently, I've seen it at the library, the Wacky Rule Book. But that, at least it was professional work. I was paid for it. And after that, Houghton Mifflin picked up the Jamaica's Find, the first book, the picture book. And that came out in 86. It was bought in 84. Mm-hmm. And if you know anything about picture books, they're not instantaneous. They weren't then. And sometimes you wait 2 or 3 years from the time that you've contracted with the publisher to the time that your book, you know, appears because of the art. The artist is going to get a year or so to work on it. And though you think your little manuscript may be perfect, it isn't, and that has to be revised. And so Houghton Mifflin, I worked with them, and still, I continue to work with them since 1984.
Do you recall, I mean, obviously, the book was not your first bylined book, but do you remember the feeling you had when you first saw the finished product?
Oh, Jamaica's Find.
Yes.
Yeah, it was... pretty wonderful feeling. First of all, if you've ever seen the book, the cover is really striking. This African-American girl with the little dog that she has found at the park and wants so dearly to keep because she's found it and she likes it. And I was really, really taken with the cover. And I had not met the illustrator. I had not exchanged one word with the illustrator.
Really?
No. Wow. I had not met her. She simply was sent the manuscript, was chosen because of her work in doing portraiture and in doing different ethnic groups.
Ah.
And it was perfect. It was a tremendous choice. And I was pretty thrilled carrying it around. And, you know, and I think even more thrilling is to be in a bookstore and to see your book in the bookstore.
Yes.
And to see a complete stranger buy the book.
Right.
And you feel like running up to them and telling them, that's my book.
You don't have to buy it. I'll pay you to take it.
Whatever. So that was pretty exciting. And of course, you know, you continue working. And I've done about 9 books or so with Houghton Mifflin.
Mm-hmm.
And 7, oh, more than that, maybe 10. 10 books, I guess, and 7 of them have been featuring Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
Who knew? We had no idea that we were going to do a series. It just didn't occur to me.
Yeah.
But what happened was this character, they're very realistic situations, and they're sort of moral stories in which she has a big choice to make.
Mm-hmm.
And I found myself, when I would come up with that kind of a situation, I would just ask, you know, okay, so what would Jamaica do? This is a 6-year-old who will be 6 forever, probably.
Really?
Yeah, she has been for 25 years. Well, actually 27 years, because the book was written in 84, and the first book was published is now 25 years old this fall. I just ask, what would Jamaica do? And I come up with a situation to, you know, be a difficult choice for her, and she's going to squirm a little, I make her suffer a little, and she just... usually, eventually finds a good, solid solution to her problem.
Mm-hmm.
And so she models behavior, you know, mm-hmm. for other kids. And they're very realistic stories, very contemporary type stories with, and I guess you could call them multicultural stories because of all the different groups that are represented.
Right.
Yeah, so and then every time I come up with that, an idea for that story, Anne Sylvia O'Brien is going to be chosen to illustrate, obviously, because she's done. She's done all of them.
It's a history with you.
And I did meet her. Oh. I finally met her. She lives on Peaks Island, across from Portland in Maine.
Oh, right.
Pretty far away. And when we moved from Minnesota to Cave Creek, 1991, must have been around October, I got a letter from Barbara Bush, who was the first lady at that time, and she was inviting me to the White House to a reception because she had a story hour. And it, remember the first lady's Barbara Bush radio story hour. And all the books that were featured on her story hour, she was inviting the authors and illustrators as it happened to go to this reception. So we had just moved, and I wasn't going to fly out to Washington. We didn't have the money. And so I had told my mother, who
was... Well, you mean they didn't pay for you flying
out?
Well,
I called Houghton, and they, and my editor said, well, I'm afraid not. If you win a prize... You know, the Ezra Jack Keats Prize, they flew me to New York. But no, you have to, you know, win a prize. They're extremely frugal. This is probably why they've survived for so long.
That's right.
And so I called my mother, who's a very staunch Republican, unlike me. And she said, oh, you're going. You know, I would think what she could tell her friends.
Right.
So I said, okay. So I called my editor and I said, you know, I'm going to go after all. And she said, well, guess what? I have good news. And because someone had not been able to go the year before, and they were going to come up with the money to send him, she said, well, obviously, if we're sending him, we're going to send you. And Annie, too, my illustrator. So we had a ball. We met. That's our first meeting.
You met at the White House?
Yeah, we had a little tour, and then we had a nice little reception and met the First Lady and her very well-behaved dog. Very well-behaved. Just right at her side. Didn't panic or it just... Incredible dog. And then,
what CIA training can do for you.
She was wonderful. And then we went to some bar across the street to have a drink, and we told the bartender, I told him, I said, you know, we just had tea with Barbara Bush. And he said, yeah, and I'm the Attorney General. So that's where I met Annie.
Your books have also been translated and used in South Africa.
Oh, yeah.
And that's just fascinating.
Sato and the Elephants was bought at Anansi Publishers by an agency in Cape Town. The book is translated, I believe, in 5 South African languages.
Mm.
And I have a tape of the Xhosa in Xhosa
is
language.
Is that the click language?
Yes.
Oh.
I have a tape of that. And then I had the veterinarian in South in Scottsdale, Afrikaans, translated in Afrikaans for me. So I have those two. I don't
Very
have the
Dutch
other.
Dutch sounding.
It is Dutch.
Yeah.
Uh huh. So I do. Well, that was exciting. It's also translated in Finnish.
Oh, beautiful.
Don't ask. I agree. I don't know why. It has not been translated in Japanese, however, and it is about a Japanese ivory carver.
I'm curious about your writing regimen. How do you write? When do you have a time of the day, a preferred implement, or do you actually pay somebody else to do the work and then take the credit?
That's a thought. No, I'm in transition. I have to be very honest. I'm in transition, and as far as my schedule, it's been about maybe 10, 11 year transition. When my husband retired, I have a different schedule. Because before, my children would go off to school. They're grown now and away. But I would walk the dog, get into my office at 8:30 or 9. Oh, I forgot I did housework, too. I did housework.
Right. Oh,
that's
detail.
Good, I think, when I do dust.
It's nice that you've forgotten it.
It's something that's eminently forgettable. And I get into my office, write my journal, 6 pages or so every day. And then that frees my mind up. Actually, what it does is it empties my mind, and it's empty mind where everything comes. And then if I have an idea, which I've gotten from my walk, I will sit down and work on it. If I have a project that I'm already working on, I'll pull that out and write until about, 3 or 4.
How long have you been keeping journals?
Oh, good question. Oh, that's fun. I had remember the little 5-line diaries?
Oh, yes.
I still have that.
Do you? So from kidhood?
I'm thinking
kidhood.
12, was I 12? 13, 14, 15, 16. Maybe it was 14 or 13. Can't remember how old I was. But it was like, went to school, fed the dog, rode my horse. That, And then when I was 16, maybe, I got one of those journals that you could write more pages
in. Oh, yes.
liberation. So I started going, and that journal. So I must have started diaries when I was probably 9 or 10.
Wonderful.
Yeah, and I have written religiously. You know, Anais Nin, and I have.
Yes.
I really have lots and lots of journals.
I do too.
I don't I don't go back and use them for stories. Mm. I use them to settle arguments.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we go back and here's what we ate at that restaurant.
That's right.
And I use them to capture dreams.
Ah.
Dream journals. Those 4 or 5 dreams you have every night. And I use them just like you practice scales on a piano. Just practice. I'm just writing. Right.
So you experiment with a description or...
Oh, yeah. A lot of descriptive writing. Some haiku will come up.
Uh-huh.
Whatever happens, wherever I go with the writing. Often when I'm really low, you know, you write more.
Yes. Oh, yes.
And so you sound like, this person is really clinically depressed. But I'm not. It's just a way of maybe emptying my mind and heart of everything that's weighing on it.
Very nice.
So I love journals. They're a wonderful way to practice your writing.
Yeah.
A wonderful way. And I that frees you up and it empties your mind. So that would be a good 45 minutes or so. Yeah. And then I would just write, pause for tea. Get a big pot of tea and bread and honey and take it in there until about 3:30 or 4. So that's a good chunk of writing. And I had everybody in my whole neighborhood trained, all my friends, everyone was trained. No one called. No one, because they knew. No one bothered.
Yeah.
And I was a bit of a hermit. And then that was Minnesota where you can do that. You've got, 6 months of winter. It's wonderful.
Right.
No one's going to bother you. And then I'd do yoga. And then have tea, and then my husband would be home, have dinner and all that.
Mm.
But then when in Arizona, it was a little different because it's really sunny and it's the temptation to be outside is terrific. And so I usually close the curtains and, work in that office, and white noise is good.
Writing longhand?
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh. I would write everything longhand first legal pad.
Ah,
I love that legal pad.
The yellow legal pad.
And I've discovered these wonderful art journals. Have you seen them where you have this big blank at the top and then lines where you can describe your sketch or whatever? Those are so wonderful because I doodle.
Uh-huh.
And that's why doodling, helps free my mind. My brain is here.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's in my mind. My hand, I'm sure. But I do now a lot of work on the computer and, with email.
Yeah, of course.
What happens, it's so absolutely terrible, is that you do so much revision when you're typing. And what I would do is just write that first draft straight out on note paper. And by the time I entered it in the computer, then you've got a good second draft.
Right.
But the first draft has that wonderful spontaneity that tells you, this is what I'm writing, because you've discovered it. And when you type, for me, when I type it, it looks so finished.
Uh-huh.
Not good. So I've got to print it out and act like I'm an editor and go there.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's a funny thing. There's a very...
It's different.
Yeah. Oh, it's very different. Very different.
Yeah.
I thought, everyone's doing this. I can do this. But I never really typed at the typewriter.
But that leads us right into something of real interest to us as well, is how you see technology and changes in our culture because of that technology impacting particularly the children and the readers that you work with.
Well, our brains will be changed, not as gradually as we think, but pretty rapidly with the nature of the internet.
Seems to be.
Our brains will change, and I wonder, our reading has already begun to change. We're not the deep readers that we have been. I don't think young people will, unless they have access to texts that demand deep reading, because the internet gives that instant gratification, we lose our patience. For the kind of deep analytical reading, the reading in which we get lost. We get lost on the internet searching. We get lost in the internet with that instant gratification.
Yeah.
Totally different kind of reading. Mm. I know, have you read The Shallows? The Nicholas Carr book?
No.
About, it's excellent, about what the internet's doing to your mind. And it's excellent about technology. And there are several books out now about the brain and technology, and obviously children who are going to be working with that will their brains will be affected.
Yeah.
It could be, we haven't always been deep readers, we haven't always had literacy, we haven't always had literature. And back when people were hunters and gatherers, what kind of information did they need? You know, when they were looking out in the fields and everything, they were constantly looking and something moved and they would focus on that. Isn't that kind of what we do, you know, when we're surfing the internet in a way?
They were.
I think that we are wired for narrative.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see how the narrative is adapted, you know, by technology. And I think it will be. And maybe it will be a combination of visual and oral. Maybe we'll go back to an oral time because it's so easy to do now with films. Films tell stories too. I probably won't make that transition, to be quite honest. I doubt if I will because I'm so tied to the words and informed by the words and love the words, and that's my medium.
Yeah.
You know, it's like someone who sketches with charcoal and, you know, they're just not comfortable using oil paints or pastels or whatever, and that's their medium.
Right.
So I think it will probably always be there, but it's certainly, we're going through an incredible age right now, and how will things shake out? Who knows? Who knows how things will shake out, you know? But I think we're in for some very big changes. I hope no one throws away their pencils.
Yeah.
I mean, what could be more simple than writing with a pencil and paper? What could be, you know, more therapeutic than writing with a pencil and paper or communicating? This is where I wonder about learning to read, because probably many of the applications now for ebooks, for now that we have the color Nooks, etc., we're putting the ebook or the regular traditional books, which are not really written to be interactive in the sense that you click something and something responds back. And so they're going to develop all the apps for the picture books, and they're doing that now. And I wonder how kids will learn to read when they, you know, you punch on something and the word will be pronounced. And is that going to be the same as the teacher that's, you know, working and
or the child who works the pronunciation out syllable by syllable?
This is true.
As probably you did and many of us.
And what happens to a narrative, and we see that already, I guess I think of apps as footnotes almost. Mm-hmm. What happens to a narrative that's fragmented, that's interrupted all the time? I don't even read footnotes until the end.
Right.
I mean, the second reading maybe, but if there's a narrative involved, I want to go through that narrative. And if we as writers, as storytellers, unless we're Victor Borg, we don't, you know, interrupt ourselves. That's part of the story. But can you imagine how would you write a story if you're supposed to build suspense, you know, to a climax, if it's interrupted constantly?
Yeah.
You know, and that's, I wonder, our sense of story is fragmented. Is that going to make us all suffer from attention deficit? And isn't that what happens when you're looking for that excitement, you know, from your little apps or something? It's wonderful to be able to have access to, you're reading a book of poetry, and that poem, you can punch on something and get a video, an interview with the poet, and isn't that great? But then what happens if you just take a poem, just the words? The first poetry class I had at the University of Illinois with Dr. Long was a book of poetry. That's all. You had the title and the poet's name and the poem. No footnotes, nothing. You just read that poem and think about that poem and write about that poem.
The way it was meant to be.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then you can do all the other stuff later. And I learned so much in that class, but how is that being taught now? But I was thinking about this future thing because I get a little anxious about the future. The technology will probably retire me before I want to retire. I will keep writing, but there's writing and there's selling what you write. Two different things. But I was thinking about the future and my anxiety about the future, and I found that what it does, that fear, that anxiety, can freeze you. And you think, oh, but what's the point? Because it's going to be ebooks, it's going to be technology, and I'm not writing for that. And I thought, well, I'm not living in the future either. I'm living now. And right now, I'm writing.
Yeah.
And so that's what I'm going to do.
Juanita, we really want to thank you so very much for sharing your time and your insights and your wit. It's just been magnificent.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We had more time. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Pleasure.
Yeah.